Hi, welcome to session 9 of the SciPag MSCP section simulation summer school. I'm joined here today, very happy to be joined here today by Karsten Luebke, who's from Applied University of Economics and Management. He's going to be talking to us about simulated data to introduce causal inference. It's a bit of a hot topic at the moment. There was a session on causal inference done by the UK repo network a couple of weeks ago, and I think it's going to be an excellent introduction. So without further ado, over to Karsten, and thank you very much.
Yes, thank you very much. I hope the micro is working.
It is.
Yeah, well, yeah. Thank you very much, and thank you for your participation in this workshop and your trust that you think that I can teach you something or you can learn something in this workshop. And as Olli said, it's a quite hot topic. And I think simulated data as your workshop series is an excellent way to introduce causal inference. And actually, you've taken the red pill by attending this workshop. And I'm a statistician by training some 20 years ago. And after learning about causal inference, I think, I've done a lot of things wrong in analyzing data. And so I hope this workshop can help you to do better than I did some 20 years ago. To be fair, some things that I'm going to tell you, we didn't know some 30 or 40 years ago when I was a student. So, well, things are improving in a way. Olli was so kind to put the link to the slides in the chat, and also we will do some kind of audience response thing. It's called tweetback, and it would be very kind if you give me some kind of feedback during this presentation and workshop, of course. You are the one who are learning and doing today. So. Perfect. And why is causal inference so important? And recently, Thomas Lumley wrote in a blog post, in causal inference, you choose your model so that one of the coefficients actually means what you want it to mean. And I think, as you all know, for example, linear regression is the workhorse for data analysis in a way. You get a lot of estimates and p-values and stuff like this, but we want to learn something about the real world, not about the mathematical betas or p's and things like that. And I think Danny Kaplan was also right when he said, sometimes we care more about the third or fourth digit of the p-value, but the first digit or even the sign of the coefficient is affected by confounding variables. And this is a more dangerous topic, so to say, than whether the variances are equal for a t-test. I don't really care about that, actually. So what am I hoping to do with you this afternoon or whatever time zone you're in? Data is not just there, it has a generating process, and we should really care about this, and simulations are a very good way to illustrate this, I would say. And confounding and bias are not only for causal inference, but also for causal inference, very serious topics. And as far as I know, most of you aren't statisticians, but applied researchers, applied scientists, so to say. And I think this is a very good way to actually link reality, theory, and data, as Thomas Lumley said, so that maybe one of the results you're obtaining is actually the one you're interested in. Okay, to introduce the elephant in the room, unfortunately, I'm not a native speaker, so be kind to me. I do my very best, but living in England was some 20 years ago for me, so I'm not used to talk in English. And I don't know, but this is an intro workshop. So if you know a lot of causal inference, you won't learn anything. Maybe some ideas, some new ideas, but this is really down on earth. And I've put the R code in the, Olli put the link to the R code in the chat. But of course, you can also copy paste it from the slides. It's quite easy. And I will do it sometimes. Okay, as this is a workshop, it's quite easy. It's impossible to please everybody, but it is impossible, but pissing everybody off is a piece of cake. So I will just start with the first quiz or on feedback. I would like just to know the audience on a novice to expert scale on feedback. How would you rate your skill in causal inference? So is it more novice or? Oh, the first results are coming in. Thank you very much. On feedback, please. I just put the link again. Zack. So I can get the result. Oops. There we are. Thanks a lot. Okay. I give it 20 more seconds. So everybody can, who wants to answer, or can answer who wants to. Not a native speaker, as I said a minute ago. That's good. That's good. That's good. At least maybe it's imposter syndrome, but no one actually said that he or she is an expert by now. And if you're on feedback, you will see the result for the moment. And I will watch the chat, but of course, quite a small group, which is great. Always ask questions if you like. That's really my experience, as Kevin Kelly said it, don't be afraid. Normally 99% of the time, everybody else is thinking this of the same question, but doesn't ask it. And sometimes I go out of a workshop or a presentation, a talk, and I don't know what they were talking about. And I think I'm the only one who didn't understand a word of that. And it turns out that even the very senior professors and things like this didn't know what this was about. So this is not a good idea for in workshop. So please, please ask questions. And I changed a bit the technical preliminaries. I will use the R package Mosaic for analysis. And I think, some of you in the workshop by Vamos, wasn't it? He did Mosaic as well. So if you haven't installed Mosaic yet, it's great for teaching. I love it for teaching. Please install it. We've got some time till we start with R coding. So in that time, you can manage that. Okay, as it is a workshop, I will start with some introduction, of course, to the topic. And actually, this is borrowed by Paul Hünemund. And I think it's a quite, oh, well, we'll see. We will see. We will see. This is a payment in a fictitious company I just invented based on the idea of Paul. And you see that, as expected, there are more males in management than females, and quite unexpected, so to say, in both job categories, the female earn more than the male. But this is the data. What's the conclusion? What is the conclusion? And feedback just hopefully, yeah. Feedback just started the second quiz. What do you think is the magnitude of the gender pay gap for this company for women? Is it the difference on average. That means that women earn £350 less than male? Or should we adjust for job? If we adjust for the job position and we think, okay, there are less women in management, so we can adjust for this, we will get something like plus 175 payment, more payment for women. So are women earning more or less? What do you think for the moment? Of course, this is not a test. Yeah? I'm not giving you any grades or something like this. I just want to introduce a topic to you. Interesting results so far. Okay, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I won't show you the result. I will show you the result in a minute, only, yeah? So 2 minutes or three, maybe two or three. I don't know. We will see, depending on how things go. Okay, this was a gender pay gap and female, male. Now, another company, but this time not gender as a categorization, but healthy or unhealthy lifestyle. So this company asks employees, are you living a healthy lifestyle or are you living an unhealthy lifestyle? And actually we get the same results, the same data, exactly the same data. And I hope most of you who answered the first question will also answer the second question. I will ask actually the same question again. What would you say is the magnitude of the healthy pay gap? What is the benefit of being healthy in this company? Did I start the quiz? Yes, I did. Is it minus 350? Is it actually a bad idea to be healthy in this company? Or is it a plus 175? What do you think? What would you say? Where are my results? Okay. Perfect. Actually, the response quote in this workshop is much higher than in my lectures so far. If I look at the participant list, excellent. Excellent, excellent. Half a minute to go. Half a minute to go. Ten. By the way, using this tool as a teaching tool, perfect. anyways, thanks a lot. So I switch back. The result for the gender pay gap was that 50-50, so to say. 50% say it's a minus. Women are discriminated, so to say. And 50% say that the other way around. And the result for the healthy lifestyle pay gap is quite different. So this time is 20% who say, well, to be healthy is not a good idea in this company. And 80% say it is, actually. Isn't it funny? I mean, it's the same data. It's the same data. It's exactly the same data. You can redo the calculation. And if you find an error, please report an issue on GitHub or something like that. But we got different conclusions. And maybe this is a data story that Peter was talking about in his reproducibility network workshops. I don't know the name. I can't remember the name. They've got a different story. Of course, this is very simplified. But actually, for the first model, it is quite reasonable to assume that whether you are in a management position or not is actually affected by your gender, unfortunately for women. And on the other way, for the second question, it is always discussable, but maybe if you are very caring about yourself and so on and so on, this actually influences, is actually influenced, sorry, other way around, influenced by your, whether you are in management, so that you can do what you want to do. That's what we sometimes think what management can do. But let me tell you, it's the other way around. If you've got less time in management than as an employee. Okay, so these are different data stories. Disclaimer, I'm a statistician and I'm a very simple-minded person. So all examples and simulations we do here are oversimplified. So please be kind. And you're a psychologist and things like this, you know much more about all this thing than I do. If you've got better ideas to boil it down to the most simple cases, I would be very interested to hear from you. Okay, first simulation. Very, very, very simplified. I would say, okay, there is some learning for students, learning time, whatever you mean, whatever you think. And by learning, you achieve some kind of knowing, hopefully. I mean, that's what we always think. But knowing isn't, at least nowadays, knowing things isn't the goal of education and learning. It is kind of understanding, so to say, that we want to understand the real world. And this is just a very, as I said, a fictitious, oversimplified example. But this is kind of basic causal idea. We think, okay, this influences that, and that influences this. And now we must, in order to simulate some data according to this, we actually need some kind of assumptions how these things are measured. You know better than I do. And we say, okay, this learning, I don't really care how we measure it for this simulation. We just say, okay, our learning is scaled to a standard normal distribution. So it's just normal distribution, standard normal. I mean, you can always scale it down. So who cares for this moment? So this is a learning time you invest. And depending on your learning time, and I just say, okay, it's 5 times your learning, you get some knowing. You learn the stuff by your learning time. This is, so your knowing is 5 times your learning. And unfortunately, there's always error in real life. It's not deterministic. Oversimplified, I just say, okay, put some error in and I'm a statistician, standard normal will always do in the long run. Of course, this is wrong, but for the simulation, we will do this. This is what I say here. Okay, there is some knowing depends on your learning. And there is some kind of exogenous, which is standard normal distribution. Ultimate goal, why is the understanding? And this depends on your knowing. I just put a 3 here. You can put whatever number you like in there. It really doesn't matter that much. And of course, also for understanding, there is also some kind of exogenous error, standard norm. Okay. in case you wondered whether I will do some math with you, no, I know this is a data simulation workshop. I've read the schedule. I just would like to translate this situation into our first simulation. And I said, okay, this is our idea of how the world behaves. And for reproducibility reasons, we must set the seat. I think this was done by all participants or lecturers or whatever in all workshops of this summer school, at least from the videos that I saw. And of course, because there's a lot of power discussions and so on, we just say, okay, our sample size is for the moment 1,000. But again, for our workshop, this is not the important part. This is not the important part. There are excellent workshops on power calculations and simulations. You can look there. And I think this is an intro workshop. I said our learning is kind of standard normal. And you know, in learning, the vector of learning, I assign a standard normal distribution of 1,000 observations. And after I've done this, and this is why causal inference is easy to understand in a way by simulation, then I said, okay, according our assumed model, our knowing, which is a Z, so our knowing, equals is assigned 5 times our learning, which we've calculated just before that. So we can reduce it plus some normal error. This is a U. Oop, there is. This is that. Yeah, that's the way. And last slide on this, or last line in this, and you've got the code, you can copy paste it. I will do it when we are doing the exercises. To be switch screens too much. Understanding our why, understanding is 3 times our knowing. Ollie put it also in there, perfect. but it's not so much code, I think you can do it. But to understand the connection, I'm a statistician, I must do that, between the mathematical assumptions or the mathematical model and the simulation model. And the causal model is the assumed model by subject matter knowledge for our simulation. That's our understanding. Yep. Okay. If you've got question, or if I'm too slow or something like this, just give me a sign and I can switch through the slides quite fast if you want to. Of course, in the end, I could have done it in a tibble right from the start, but to make it as simple as possible, I put everything together, all these vectors into a data frame. This is what I do here. I've got some data about the learning. I've got some data about the knowing, and some data about the understanding. And now I start my mosaic library. I could have done this before. Doesn't matter at all for the moment. And there we are. Now we've got our data. And as I said, t-test, ANOVA, everything is linear regression. I really don't understand why we teach all this different stuff. So I actually stopped doing so. And it don't matter if you're frequentist or Bayesian.
model with some alphas and betas and X's and Y's and I's and J's and K's in, and it don't mean a thing if you don't do modeling.
Yeah, it don't mean a thing if you don't do modeling, but what kind of modeling? It wasn't my singing. I can put the link. I can't sing. And maybe Olli next time with your guitar from the other videos. we do some kind of modeling. But how? How do? As I said, Thomas Lumley's quote, you causal inference, you hope that one of the coefficients means what you want it to mean. If I understand it correct. And we are interested actually in the effect of learning for on understanding. It's not a bad idea. I mean, if you tell the students, you do some learning, you'll do some understanding. And so to say, as Peter said in his excellent presentation, we do care more about Holger, it's in the course web fun connections. I make a break sometimes and I will find it for you. It is a course web fun connections. It's by Greenacre. It don't mean a thing. I will put the link in the, it's the end. This was from my PC, but I've got the link where I got it from. Post it in the, I will find it in the break. Okay. I'm lost. I remember we are more interested actually in estimation and of course in uncertainty in the estimation than in testing, but we can also do testing as well. And you can see whether we actually adjust, control, match, pair, whatever you like it, for knowing or without adjusting for knowing, we will get very different results. Actually, as you can see, over here, 15 compared to 0.12. I mean, that's an order of magnitude. And you can, of course, play around with the numbers, you will get different results. And actually, 2 years ago, Julia Pearl published a paper about a ladder of causation, which I find interesting. In a way, and he distinguishes three levels, rungs, he says, he calls it now. The first rung is just in quotation marks, association. It's probability of Y given X. This is not bad. It's sometimes we are quite interested in that. But if you want to improve the world, if you want to make it a better world, so to say, and that's why some of us are doing research and all this stuff, is we actually do an intervention. We do an intervention, or we are interested in the effect of an intervention. That is a what if question. So in our example, and what if a student learns 20 hours? Can't fit it in a standard normal. But if the student will achieve an X value of 2, what will happen then? What is the probability that he will or she will understand the world? That is an intervention. And I really, really, sorry, I like the do operator because it makes it clear that we actually set X to some value. We don't take X for given, but we actually set the X value. And this is quite funny, I think, with a lot of assumptions, with a bunch of assumptions, we can also estimate counterfactuals. So for our given student, of course, oh, well, I've learned 15 hours and I got an B. What if I would have learned 20 hours? What would be my result then? So this counterfactual and is the just pure imagination. And I like it that we can actually do imagination. I mean, it's quite an important thing. Okay. So we've got two modeling results and I just started the next quiz on TweetBack.
Oh, Karsten, we've just got a quick question, if that's okay, just on chat.
But sure.
They've been coming to me from direct messages, so you've probably not been seeing them. We've got a question from Fabian asking, could I have a bit of explanation regarding the do versus the see operator, if possible?
Sure. I didn't see it. Sorry.
No, yes, it came directly to me. Sorry, that's why.
Okay, as I put it. Just thinking of a good example. Okay. I put it in a set. You question students didn't, and they answer the truth and so on. Yeah. How long do you learn? And you get your x values. These are just you see the x values. And so, meinetwegen, Carsten, that's me. Carsten was 20 hours. Carsten was learning 20 hours. Observation. And maybe. We will get back to that later. In randomized experiments or something like this, you said, okay, Carsten, you learn 40 hours. Not really, kind of, yes. I will come back later to Sarah's remark. You can actually do this without an experimental design. And you say, okay, the X value is not chosen by me. but by imagination, so to say. And I don't know whether I answered that question. Another example, I work for a company and we made some advertising and direct mailing campaigns and so on. And you observe, see, sorry, I was just walking through the chat. We observe, okay, if we do a margin of 5%, how much do the sales go up? That is the observation. As a company, we were more interested in what would happen if the next time we will make a margin of 5%? When we actually do set the X value, that's the important, for a company at least, it was the important question. I don't know whether I answered that question, but it's actually, okay. I don't know whether this was the one who asked it, but otherwise always there. Yes, so we actually set X, and yes, okay. What is coming back? Sorry, oops. What is the total causal effect? This is on feedback. Total causal effect from learning on understanding. Is it the coefficient without adjusting for knowing? Or is it the coefficient with adjusting for knowing? As you can see, they are different. They are different. Nope. fourth choice. According to this model, well, I will come back to that later. This is interesting. This is really interesting. 50-50 choice. I do this, actually, I do this thing in my intro class, intro stats courses as well. And my students, I'm telling this, at this situation, I'm saying, I'm a lecturer. Do you really think I will give you an example where learning is not important? I wouldn't do that, no way. And this is actually under our given model. And that is what Sarah really Sarah really pointed out. It's always conditional on the causal model. And I think that is what also David means in his comment. I'm not sure whether it was right or not, but that, yeah. Okay. Wrong screen, sorry. And coming back from simulations to some theory, mix it up a bit. I haven't introduced an arrow so far. I haven't introduced anything like duck, and at least those who are quite familiar know are expecting a kind of duck. And an arrow just means that my Y depends on my X. My Y is listening to my X, but not the other way around. Unfortunately, my example, when I was young, I was growing up and my weight growth, this finished some years ago. And now my height is not listening to my weight at some, any longer. So Y is listening on X, but X is not listening on Y. And there is at the moment no restriction on the F or the U and so on. There's no parametric or some anything restriction at the moment. This is an intro workshop. We do the most simple case, normally distributed and additive models. That's the most easy. But if you haven't got any errors in your data, or in your assumed model, this is actually the stronger assumption. That means that there is no direct causal relationship. What I have just introduced was a chain. That's just a name dropping for the moment. A chain is X influences Z, and Z influences Y. That is called a chain. And as for psychologists and sociologists and others, economics, metrics, in this case, that is a mediator in this case. It's called a mediator between the exposure, our X, and we are interested in the effect of X and the outcome, Y. And there's this bunch of discussion whether you call it adjusting, controlling, conditioning, and I don't like this discussion. I actually prefer the wording of adjusting because sometimes we can't control it. But never the mind, if we are controlling or adjusting this mediator, we will close the causal path between the exposure and the outcome. And because, Y depends on X only via Z. So maybe lesson learned from the first simulation, if you're interested in the total causal effect, you can always distinguish between direct and indirect effect, but this will be another simulation workshop next year, maybe. This is actually not the best idea, I must say. And normally, you need not to be sure that our statistical quantitative measures will tell you that. You normally look at your IEC and p-values and whatever you like, and not necessarily they will tell you that. And just to give you a real life example, I was in a conference some month ago, and there was the question whether socioeconomic status of a woman influences the fertility of the women. So that was the research question, so to say. The number of childs a woman will give, whether this is connected to the socioeconomic status. That was a question, and actually they controlled, adjusted for age at first birth. This is a mediator. Of course, how many children you will give birth to depends on when you start with it. And this is, post-treatment adjustment, adjusting for a mediator. You, as you've seen in our example, different results in an order of magnitude, and wow, goes bang. Goes bang. Okay. 40. Yeah, okay. I think we'll start with the second, and then we will do the break in between the second example. So off we go, second simulation. Second example. And now we can start with a duck. Because now you know what an arrow is, as you didn't know before, I guess you know. But it's quite easy. And as I said, it's fictitious, it's oversimplified. It's a toy example. It's a toy, just to get the idea. And whatever you define, whatever you understand under the word intelligence, subject matter, experience, whatever, you are better than I am. You can actually say, okay, if you are smart, you understand faster. If you want to learn a thing, if you're very intelligent, you are faster in learning stuff, I would say. And also, being a lecturer, I think that the clever students actually make higher grades in the exams. It's unfair. It's very unfair because they need to learn only a shorter time, but they still get the better grades. I mean, it's unfair in a way. But as I said here, intelligence, that, and X increase test score Y. So we've got our exposure, X. We've got our outcome, Y. And this is something new. This actually, as you can see, the arrow goes only from Z to X and from Z to Y. This is different than the chain we had on the previous slide. This is the duck, the directed acyclic graph for the situation. And as you can see, no idea what kind of relationship, and this is a qualitative assumption about the data generating process encoded in a graph. That's it. And now, first time your move, I put some silly results or silly numbers in it. I said our intelligence is, how did I manage this? Normally distributed with a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 50. This is here. And then just to put some numbers in for simulation, then I say, okay, my learning time, that was our exposure, the learning time. We are interested in the effect of the learning time is 200, that's 200, minus that was our intelligence, and some exogenous U. I don't really care, I just put a standard normal in it. And really, this is not important. This is not the story. Yeah, just an James. Yes, just an exogenous. Not a variable, not in the model. It must not be an error, but it's exogenous. Yes. Not necessarily an error, but here, just some kind of which we didn't observe here. And now comes your part. Why our test score is 0.5, your intelligence, plus 0.1, your learning time. Yes, it is. It's a convention that to make sure that it's not just error, it's exogenous, we put an U there. James, yes. Okay. Try it yourself. Sorry, it's a workshop. Please, when you're ready, just give some kind of yes or no or whatever you like a reaction, please. Oh, Sarah is always, oh, Oliver. Oh, okay, this was too easy. No, but in class, in class, it's always, don't only care about the fast ones. You'll lose the other ones. Ah, James, I don't know the word, but I think you're great. And actually, I don't know whether you've been cheating. As Ollie was so kind to put the link to the slides, there's actually the answer. That's how I managed computer science in school those days. Because there was this, we were the first with a network, and I found the results from the other students those days. Wouldn't do this today, of course. Was a use. Yes, I think it wasn't too complicated. James, please check yourself whether you've done it correctly or not. And it's just 0.5 times our intelligence plus 0.1 times learning time plus some random error. And if you have also set the seed for reproducibility, I think last time Oliver didn't put it in, you will get the same results as I did. And it don't mean a thing if you don't. By myself, yes, thanks for you. It's my gut feeling for white spaces. And again, we are interested in the same thing. What is the effect of the learning time on our test scores? And I hope this time, is it minus 0.4? Tweet back again. Minus 0.4? Or is it plus 0.08? What do you think is the right effect if you increase learning time? Feedback. Let's have a look. Half have answered so far. I give it 30 more seconds for you to think over it. I guess most of you learned I'm a teacher, I'm a lecturer. I wouldn't say that learning time is actually a bad idea for a test score. Yes, perfect. Oh, well. This time, yes, sure. This time, it's a very different story. This is something different than before. So this time, it's the other way around. And I think this is not the break, but we smooth into the break. We will smooth into the break.
Hello, my name is Raphael, and in today's episode, we are going to investigate a paradox. No, not this paradox.
I can't make it full screen. Sorry.
Yes, this one.
I think Raphael deserves that he also gets the this thing. I think I can only encourage you. He's made something like 10 or 11 summary songs this term, and I really like them. They are actually quite great, and no animals were harmed during the production of this video. This is also important, of course. No, I think a great sense of humor, at least for my in my terms. And to answer the question Suzanne was asking, this time that our intelligence is a confounder. It affects both the exposure and the outcome in this case, and adjusting or controlling, conditioning, whatever you like to call it, will actually close this non-causal path between exposure and outcome. And I guess a lot of you are kind of familiar with spurious correlation, this internet page about spurious correlation. There always, at least almost always, time is a confounder for the both variables who are highly correlated. The time causes, Tyler Weigand was the name of the guy who was a spurious correlation internet page, who actually is confounding by the time. Okay, so I think I'm just unprepared. The next quiz is on its way, whether you need a 5 minute break or a 10 minute break. On TweetBack, you will get now 5 minute break or 10 minute break. What would you prefer? 20 seconds to go. But Olli, you can prepare for a 5 minute break. Actually, at the moment, there's 75%. But let's have a look. I hope I can find the song Holger asked for in that time. Okay, perfect. So it wasn't. Miguel, I will come back later to that. So make first the break. Break till Olli, you are in your time zone. Maybe you can.
Sure. Yeah, no problem. Okay. So I guess we'll meet back at 2:05, if that's okay with everybody. So
that was the decision.
That was the decision. Yes, we've got a 5 minute break. So I'll go and grab a coffee. Unfortunately, I've got a coffee machine right next to me, so I'm good. But yeah, I'll see you in 5 minutes, 2:05. BST.
So see you later.
Hello.
Hello. Can you still hear me?
I can still hear you. Yes. We're not. We haven't had that issue again. I didn't stop recording, so I've got a bit of space to delete when it comes.
Oh. Not too bad to get coffee.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Okay. I guess it's 5:05 the hour now, so I guess we can get started again.
Okay. Perfect. Not coffee, water. I come back to Miguel's question. The first element we had was a chain, and I said, okay, this kind of arrow means that the variable at the where the arrow is pointing on, the value of that variable depends on the other one. They are actually called the parent and the child in graph language. And being a father, I know this is wrong, but the idea is that the child, Y, is listening to X, the parent, and not the other way around. But yeah, this is wrong, but nevertheless, the idea is quite nice. And we had the chain in the first example simulation, and actually, if we put this variable in the model by adjusting it or putting it a covariate in a linear model, we kind of hold it fixed. We say, okay, that is whatever that is. And so the connection, what X is doing, is in a way interrupted, blocked. And this is, yes, that is, you know, Sarah just also put an answer on it as well. So in a chain, you're interrupting the flow of information from X to Z by adjusting, which is actually not the thing you should do in a fork. You should adjust in a chain. You shouldn't, sorry, the other way around. You should in a fork, because your linear model doesn't know that actually X is listening to Z. They are treated like the same way. X and Z are treated the same in the linear model. But as we know here, X actually is listening to Z. We should hold it fixed. And we can do so in a regression model by putting it into the equation, as we did in the second model. We put it in our regression equation. Oops, doesn't go that way. So this was our exposure. And we put it in our equation. So in a regression, that means that this coefficient, as usual, does mean all other things being equal. And this is the important part, that all other things being equal means intelligence being equal, as we were interested in the effect of the learning time on the test score. I hope this makes it a bit more clearer. And it's actually called closing the backdoor path. We are interested in this arrow. This is what we are interested in, what we want to know. And there's also this backdoor. Yeah, we should not adjust in a chain. Yeah. But in a fork scenario. Here, adjusting for a mediator in a chain is interrupting the causal flow of information, the correlation. And here we want to close, that's a terminology for this, we close a backdoor path from X to Y by putting it in the model. I hope this helps. And there is a very convenient and well-known way how this can be done. That is the way randomized controlled trials or randomized experiments work. In a way, randomized experiments get you a duck or a graph, which is easy to agree on, because you as the experimenter say randomly what the value of X is. X, in our fictitious oversimplified example, the learning time. The learning time is not determined by your intelligence, but by the experimenter, the scientist. It is not the connection to the parents of X, whatever there are, is cut. That is the way why we can agree that we say sometimes no correlation without no causation without experimentation, because now when we assign the value of X, we've got it cut it from its parents. That's the way it works. I hope this answered the question. And again, adjusting for a confounder is a quite good idea. We should do so. And as I said before, p-values, r-squared, and all this stuff do not necessarily tell you that you should do so. Okay. Ready for the third simulation? Okay, at least Olli is saying yes. So good. And this is the most surprising one. This is the most surprising one. At least it took me the longest time to understand it. Dating. Why are you, and it's oversimplified, it's fictitious, bah, bah, bah. I said it many times. And I'm a very simple-minded person. And why are you dating someone? Maybe you are dating someone because he or she is good looking. Oh, wow, he looks nice. Or you date someone. Yeah, Holger, yes. Adjust for a component, you just control, condition, whatever in the data. Yes, Holger, thanks. There are, of course, other reasons why you should date someone. I think humor is the most important one, but I think kindness is also good. It's not a bad idea that you date someone because he or she is kind. So you see no arrow between X and Y. This means they are independent. The stronger assumption is that there is no arrow. This means both are independent. Okay, but nevertheless, we can, and this is looks worse than it actually is, we can simulate data according to this model. And again, I said, okay, good looking. Looking is standard normally distributed. Kindness is also standard normal distribution. And mathematical notation. You date someone either if he/she is at least in don't know the quantile at the moment, but it's above average for good looking. And actually it's an or you date someone because he or she is above average in terms of kindness. And the last line does mean, okay, there's always luck. I mean, sometimes you date someone because, well, just of luck, and you miss a date because of bad luck. This is the exogenous you. And as this is a very complicated example, I've put the R code over here. So faster than Ollie at this time. As I said, our kindness, I should have done it the other way around, sorry, is standard normal distributed, our looking as well, and our dating without luck and bad luck is you date someone whether he or she is especially kind, or this is a R notation for or, the logical or, if he, she is above average, much above average in dating, in good looking. And now I introduce some luck and bad luck. There we are. So you will get the exercise in a minute or 2 or 3 minutes, but here we are. Remember, no arrow between X and Y, between kindness and looking. Now we put it all together again. James, to distinguish the Z from the final Z. That is an intermediate step. So, thank you, James, for the question. The tilde doesn't represent anything. Just to distinguish the two Zs in my model. Sorry for that, but I thought, well, if I use the same notation, it would be strange. And to make the data more understandable, I said, okay, this is a deplier mutate. I don't know whether you are familiar with the tidyverse or not. It will work also in normal R, but I like actually. I don't know that. I'm used to tidyverse nowadays. I said, okay, our data frame consists of good looking, dating, and kindness. And this is a pipe operator. And that what we've done before now flows into the next R function, the next thing we do. And this is just, okay, to make it more readable, dating is, if we date someone, the logical variable date, we say, okay, it is a date. And if it is not a date, then it's no date. You didn't date this one. By the way, Alison Horse has done some really incredible, great R artwork. Unfortunately, I'm not creative at all, so I must depend on other person's work for this. Just have a look at it. The link is, it's all this red stuff is linked with something if you press on it. Again. You know this game by now. We are interested in the effect, causal effect of looking on kindness. Yes, looking on kindness, our situation. And again, you'll see that we get different results. Once without adjusting, it's close to nothing. And with adjusting, it's close to minus 0.15. Again, with or without dating. What should we do? Tweet back. I put the link in. Wow. I give you a bit more time. I was too fast. Sorry. This time it's a dating, Jason. This time it's dating. Sorry. or you mean for this example? Yeah, that would be. Yeah, perfect. Thanks a lot. Here are your results. The final call is 3/4. Just like the timing for the break. 3/4 say without adjusting is a good idea. And 25% say, okay, we should adjust. You mean copy paste here. Sorry. Yet now I understand. Sorry, G. Sorry, yet I see here wrong. with adjusting for date. And actually, this is the world famous, not as famous as Simpson, so there isn't a song that I'm aware of. This is the Berkson's paradox. This is a Berkson's paradox where actually adjusting is causing a correlation where there isn't one in the data. And you can see it here for those who you are not dated, or except for those with good luck, there is no correlation. But for those you dated, there is one. And this is called a collider or anti-fork or whatever you name it. I like actually by now the collider. And this, in technical terms, this is a quite, or anti-fork, yes, sounds better. This is because that, in this case, is an effect of both, of the exposure and the outcome. And this means that, being a statistician, I must speak technical sometimes, while X and Y are marginally independent, they are conditionally dependent. If we are adjusting, controlling, you name it, you've got it, for a collider, we will open a so-called biasing path. And this is, my lecture example is, holidays and weekends are in a way independent. But in both cases, you can stay longer in bed. So if you stay longer in bed and you know it isn't on holiday, it must be weekend. You know something about whether it's weekend or not, if you can stay in bed, which you don't know in the other way around. If you know it's weekend, it may be holiday or not. They are marginally independent, but knowing that you can stay in bed longer, they are dependent from each other. You get some information. This is quite funny. So now it's your turn again. It's your turn again. Please try to, this is for those who are familiar with R, perhaps you can find out the correlation coefficient between good looking and kindness for those you dated. So let's have a look how long this will take to find this out. Filter is a kind of R function you might use, and coral is a R function for correlation coefficient. We first are already finished. I'm a very conservative one, James. I'm old. I'm not used to new things. I started using R in version 1. Something. So all this fancy new stuff. So perfect, Sarah. It's piping. The new pipe is a base R piping, not Margarita piping. That's all. I don't know whether it's better to debug the old pipe. The Margarita pipe is quite hard to. Yeah, Mosaic core does. Anyway, we don't want to go into too technical details. And my weekend example. In your sample, you've got a correlation coefficient from minus 0.33. Although by construction in the population, not in your sample, in the population, the correlation coefficient is zero by construction. And with an example to stay in bed, there must be reasons why you dated someone. If it wasn't the good looking, it must have been the kindness. And of course, there's always luck. And I think Waltz airplane is quite a lot in social media, and you can see, okay, and I don't know whether you actually know all know this story. That was in the Second World War, where they discovered that the planes they are investigating who did, yeah, Sarah, it's a survivorship bias. The airplanes that came back to the airport were not hit where the pilot was sitting. And they said, okay, though this is not the important part of the plane, but actually it was only the planes who came back. So that's survivorship bias. So hit and location may be independent, but surviving of the plane or the pilot is actually a conditioner there. So there was a negative correlation, so to say, or there was a correlation between those two. What was only there because of the sample that they've got. So you know the story so far, adjusting for a collider. But, and now comes the good news, there are tools who actually tell you whether you should adjust or not adjust. And Dougherty is really great for it. And I'll show you in a minute. Bloop, there we are. Launch Dougherty in your browser. And there you can model. New model, new model. Bye, James. I hope you enjoyed it or learned something. Model, new model. Yeah, you can. No, you don't need to install it. Sorry, Ari, for the situation. We just, I would like the last example I would like to do is just some drawing, some drawing of a duck. Yeah, it's at the website. Yeah. Sure. So Dougherty would have told you so. And we are on our way out of this workshop. And now some real stuff. Let's think about gender, ability, management, and salary. And the first thing I would like you to draw kind of duck for this. How does it go? So if you launch it in a browser, I can make it a bit larger, I think. Yes. Model, new model. And if you just press on the canvas, you can create a new variable. I'd say gender. Another press on the canvas. what did I say? It said ability.
Ability.
Another press on the canvas, and you got the management. And another one, you get the salary. So what we are missing at the moment, cancel. What we are missing is in the moment are the arrows. What? Maybe you can answer in the chat. What arrows are you expecting in this simplified where shall I draw some arrows? Gender to management. Gender to management. Go. Gender to salary. Gender to a salary. Ability to, what was the ability? Ability to management. And management to salary. And ability to salary. Okay. Okay. This is, and again, the strong assumption, the strong assumption is that there is no arrow whatsoever between gender and ability. And that's what I like it actually. You can say, okay, gender is our exposure and salary is our outcome. And you can actually see which adjustment sets you should do to actually, oh, Jenny isn't looking that happy at the moment. Sorry if I'm too fast.
You're fine, Karsten, technical issues.
Okay. Of course, there. To the question in check, it could be better, and the model could be improved by some temporal layers as well. Yes, sure. there's no limit in a way. But actually, what Dougherty tells you is what you need to do to adjust or not to adjust for your effects you're interested in. And it also tells you, I didn't mention this, this is for the advanced workshop, that this models implies testable implications. And you can export the R code and all this stuff. And you can also say that, as in real life, that maybe ability is unobservable. And then you will still get the results, whether you could adjust or not adjust. And if you are saying, okay, I adjust for management, then it will say, okay, the total effect cannot be estimated. You can't estimate it with this model and things like that. Okay. Yeah, try it. last exercise. And I've known before that you will end up with such a duck. let's say, okay, gender. with a probability, well, we'll get the results in a minute anyway. Gender with a probability for being a woman of 0.5, binary gender for simplicity. Sorry for that. Say, okay, ability, normal distribution, 115, And unfortunately, folk theory says women need an ability above 130 to get a job in top management. Women, men only 115. Salary is 10 times the ability. Men earn 5% more. And if in top management, the salary increases by 50%. Try. I'm cruel, yes. Okay, I don't know whether you're finished or not, but in order to finish the workshop on time, I will get through the answer. And I think the idea is, I hope at least the idea of this concept is now visible in a way. Wrong screen, sorry. Yep. So, what do I do here? I say, okay, gender is either female or male, either female or male. And independent of this, the ability is normally distributed. Now comes the first women discrimination part, so to say. When you're in management, you are in management. If you're a female and your ability is above 130, so quite a high bar to jump over. Or if you're a male and your ability is just something like above 150. This is didactic, not so good. Otherwise, you're not in management, as most people aren't in management. And then I said, okay, the salary is 10 times the ability. And then the another discrimination of women is that the salary is 1.5 or 5% higher for male than for the non-male, that is the women in our simulated data. And if you are also, this could have been an if-else statement, as of course as well, case when you're in management, you will get 50% more. That means 0.5 times the salary. For simplicity, I mean, to fit it on a one slide for this workshop, I omitted the exogenous values for management and salary, but they wouldn't change the story. The story would have been the same exogenous U value. Well, for time reasons, calculate the mean salary as expected, as construction, as by James, to be honest, normally I start without the error and then I edit normally to see what happens. I'm playing around. I don't know whether this is a good idea, but that's the way I do it. I start without the errors to get the picture and then I hope that the errors won't mix everything up. Kind of sensitivity analysis in a way. Must be some sensitivity. Good. As you can see, the mean salary for women is much lower than for men, as expected by construction. But as also by construction, if you filter by those who are in management, you will observe that, and this was the case in Germany. We got this issue 6 months ago that it was in the newspaper. Hoorah, women in top management earn more than men. And so this can't be that, it can't be true that women are discriminated against. And this is utterly wrong. This is utterly wrong because to be in top management, you must be a really, really very clever ability. Very clever women. And as you will see it in this simulated data, here it is the same. Women in management earn more than the men in management, but this is because they are much more, their ability was higher than those of men. And you can also add other effects like confounding and moderators and things like this as well. As the general causal model we put here is has no functional form. It does not depend on linear assumptions or something like this. Okay, so if you've just woken up, what was my intention with this workshop? And I hope it was similar to the intention of the organizers of the summer school. I think causality and directed asset graphs together with data simulations provide a framework to think more clearly about the data generating. Oh, gee, from, oh, wow. Oh, wow. Thanks a lot for attending. I hope you're satisfied again. I think these assumptions we should include, as they have got heavy consequences for our estimator, for the estimate of interest. That was Pete was talking about a lot, I think. What is your estimate? What do you want to learn? What is the effect you're interested in? And simple-minded toy examples may help to understand an idea what's going on. And to be honest, when I was younger, I just put everything in my model and think, oh, well, variable selection and stuff like this will sort it out for me. And I'm not that sure any longer with that approach of mine, but well, still learning. So if you want to learn more, Julia has written an excellent, non-technical, much easier to read than my slides example in it. Thinking clearly about correlations and causation is excellent. Open access, as far as I know, are highly recommended. A bit more technical, but still one of those short introductions that I like is those of Felix Elvert. Rather old, but still 2013. If you want even more, I think a lot of you are doing kind of structural equation models. Judea Pearl has written a paper on it, which is readable, I think. And also by Julia, and Paul and others, popular pass medals. yes, Sarah. But don't be afraid of what the errors you made. I'm happy that I learned and improved. Although I feel ashamed for what I've done wrong in my life so far. Although this is about health data in the International Journal of Epidemiology, there's a recent paper which has some nice guidance how to draw a duck and things like this, independent of the subject matter. And that's a good thing for me as a statistician. As Tuki said, we can play around everywhere in everybody's backyard. everybody uses statistics somewhere. I think it's a bug, not a feature. The usual critique is, but the correctness of the conclusion is based on the correctness of the graph. Yes, but is unconscious wishful thinking really better? I would say no, at least at this time in my life, I would say no. And as a friend of mine said, regarding Bayes statistics, Bayes is critics for you need a prior. Yeah. And do you criticize Pythagoras for that you need to know 2 out of 3 sides to calculate the 3? And in a way, I would say it's the same here. This is no free lunch. Without your assumptions encoded in this graph, you can't draw your conclusions. That's the title of Hernan's course, which is quite nice as well. Yes. Whew, you're finished. there is, of course, a source. I thought you left us. the source of all the slides and so on is available. I've spent a lot of time for the colors. Actually, it's all our markdown. you can copy paste it. You can learn from my mistakes. I've got, actually got a paper on this. If you, what would I say? If you will, this is motivation for my fellow statisticians, why I think, and others, of course, sorry for the plural, why I think this is important. And I actually teach it in intro stats. I actually do it in intro stats. This workshop was about data simulations. There's also a real life example as a tutorial, which you can try for yourself. If it wasn't for simulation, I would have just put that in and saved me some time. Of course, you can always send me an email, and I'm not that active as Jenny or something like this, but last year I started using my Twitter account. Before that, I just use it for text mining, the account. Yes, Holger, Dougherty, actually, there are some mathematical rules. Depending on the graph, you can develop rules, whether you should adjust or not adjust. And Dougherty actually has implemented these rules. They are fun for teaching to do it by yourself, but actually, when the graph is more complicated, Dougherty would have told you so. Yes, thank you very, very, very much. I hope I was worth your trust as you turned up this morning, Jill, in Los Angeles. It's afternoon in Dortmund. If you've got any question, just ask them.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we've got time for questions. And thank you so much, Karsten. That was absolutely amazing. That's enjoyable to watch, and I've learned loads as well. So this is amazing. If anyone has any questions, please feel free to fire them across now. Oh, and someone got someone from Ecuador, and it's 8:53. Wow, you are early birds.
Yes.
Great. So the video will be, as always, will be put up on YouTube in the next few hours. I suppose it usually takes about 2 or 3 hours to process and all that sort of stuff.
Leave the break in.
I'll leave the break in there, yeah. Maybe everyone else has to go. And I'll leave the songs in there as well, obviously. Great. Thanks very much, everyone. We'll see you on Friday at 5 p.m. BST for Oscar's talk on simulating non-normal data, multivariate non-normal data, which promises to be excellent as well. Thanks very much.
Yeah. So thank you. And yes, I hope that you learned something.